Okay, so we looked at 111 and its cognates 1110 and 1111 in our last video about Enochian squares. We also looked at the concept of resurrection in the Great Pyramid and the Vitruvian Man. And then we saw here the actual way it would appear on the Giza Plateau. If you drew it, you get 1,110. 1,110 megalithic yards. You know, some of the people that started this whole thing with sacred geometry say the megalithic yard is one of the main units of measurement, 1,110. Okay, then you get it when you do the square, and then you also get it when you go across on the diagonals through the middle. Okay, so incredible, 1,110. So 111 is amazing, which is what 1,110 means, and then the fulfillment of that is 111 amazingness and 1,111, okay?
So you got the number 1, the number 20, and the number 100. So 121 is the length in cubits of that Queen's Chamber shaft. And it happens to be 11 times 11. And here's why I say,
now I should mention here that those numbers are what was found inside the secret door that's inside the Queen's Chamber passage in the Great Pyramid. It took a robot to find those numbers we just saw. They've been hidden until the 21st century.
Say that. Okay, so here's the Great Pyramid. So I did a quick sketch here. So look at this. So if I put a line where at the 105th course, which is where the air shaft from the King's Chamber exits the pyramid, and then again the same thing on the other side, the 105th course, the other air shaft of the King's Chamber exits there, and then if I draw the lines up from the very corner vertice of the pyramid there, okay, look at this. It's 11 times 11 cubits from the vertice to the 150th course, going just horizontal, and the same thing on the other side, of course, going from the southern vertice going to the 105th course on a horizontal. It's 11 times 11 cubits. And then the 198 cubits in the middle are 9 times 11 plus 11. So, you know, I just think that it's incredible that these numbers are in the Great Pyramid.
Okay, so amazing, amazing, amazing. At least I think this whole 111 thing. You know, we saw it in the adding up of the diagonals, the verticals, the 14 places, sort of the resurrection. And we got the Jed pillar. Here, symbolizing resurrection, matching the Great Pyramid and an ancient, symbol of Egypt that's resurrection. You've got Vitruvius, the Roman architect. You've got Da Vinci. You've got the Great Pyramid. All these coming together. So what did I find for my sister about 111 besides all this? Because I told her I was going to do some searches on the web. Well, when I did, I was reminded of a book I read back in the 70s, because searching for 111 on the internet led to this. This is Jerry Lucas. He was an all-pro basketball player with the New York Knicks. I could say a lot of things about him. He even though he's an all-pro basketball player, he wasn't fulfilled by simply just, dribbling on the court. He would be doing numbers in his head and memorizing things while he's playing professional basketball. So he wrote a book in the 70s with Adele Washburn called Theomatics, in which he said that the Greek and the Hebrew language, which each one of the letters in those languages that are biblical in the languages, have numerical values. So every letter, every word, every phrase, every sentence in both Hebrew and Greek has a numerical value. So he started putting it together. He says, well, Huesus is 111 times 8. Christon, 111 times 12. The phrase, the birth of Jesus was thus, 111 times 49. She will bear a son, 111 times 11. Behold the virgin, 111 times 27. She bore a son and called his name, 111 times 24. To you a sign, the virgin shall be with child. It's 888, which is 111 times 8. The babe in the womb, 111 times 13. The fruit of thy womb, 111 times 14. The Lord, 111 times 9, the days to bear, 111 times 5. Okay, so you get the idea here. In the book Theomatics, they found all these connections to 111, to Jesus, and everybody knows in the world that they're either they believe it or it's a myth that he rose, but the whole religion is built on the idea that Jesus rose, and the number 111 is associated with him in these two languages. Okay? The babe lying in the manger, 111 times 22, this child, 111 times 26, blessed is the... So, I'm going to finish this with an amended clip from a previous video where I explained the rise of the Vitruvian Man and the Great Pyramid and the whole idea of resurrection there. Okay, so here we go.
Easy for him to do it that way, so he didn't blot the ink. Well, there could be probably more with Da Vinci, though, probably more than that. Okay, so in our last video, you saw that there's this 5 times the size of an elevation view of the Great Pyramid. Great Pyramid that's formed on the Giza soil, defined by the center of Khufu and the center of Menkaure. Interesting, okay? So, I superimposed the Da Vinci Great Pyramid picture, basically from Alan Green, reworked it a little bit, over the that what I call the Giza overlay map. You can see those upper chambers that are sort of prophesied, you know, because we don't know of those in the Great Pyramid, but it seems like they're there, okay? So somebody, I put this on Instagram, that the picture you're looking at, and one of my followers said, the face. And so I looked at it again, I thought, yeah, there is a face there. There's an eye, you know, there's a mouth, you got kind of a nose there too. So that's the face, but look at that face, I'm thinking is above the face that Da Vinci drew, okay? So there's the idea of ascension, you know? This is the point. That's this from our last video. It's the solar boat pit. That upper chamber is right where the solar boat pit would be. So all the things we talked about in the last video, the idea of ascension, of the king taking his last trip, going to the next life, and all that. So that's what's kind of revealed there. So Da Vinci's Vitruvian Man face is down there, but that's saying to me, because remember my follower saw a face. There's a face there. Move up. Move the face up. So this is the whole idea of Egyptian cosmology, cosmogony, theology, the resurrection, all these tombs and all these spells, the Book of the Dead and all this. Let's get this king to rise. The Great Pyramid is trying to help us with our ascension. Okay, so here's the Vitruvian Man. So there's the circle that Da Vinci put on it. Well, Alan Green added a few circles you can see here to get the Great Pyramid placed correctly in relationship to those lines that Da Vinci drew. And so there's the lines that Alan Green added, the circles. So I put a head there. Will Wire, my graphics companion here, he drew the man up a little higher. So you get the idea just where that was suggested, sort of from just below the peak of the Great Pyramid to now. But let's put the head where the apex is, the capstone, the Ben Ben, the idea of the phoenix rising. So we're getting all these, and then look at all those arms. It's like bird's wings. It's like we're ascending now. Raise the man. There's that head, okay? And then if you go to that next circle, it goes from being, you know, at the capstone to now you're rising above the capstone up there. Wow. Okay, so we know that Da Vinci hides stuff. So the lines, as far as the Great Pyramid, we showed those, but Da Vinci also has some angled lines instead of just the straight horizontals. And so the ones that are in the red and blue here, you can see they kind of go down. But I was interested in these other lines that he has little markers to. Look at that. It goes up. It goes up. And so I tried to figure the scale based as best I could on figuring the angles and stuff. And if you follow those lines to where they come together, it's over 3,000 meters up. That's almost 2 miles. Now, I put not to scale because it would actually be off the computer screen, but you get the idea here. So I'm getting this idea, again, from Da Vinci. I'm not making this up. This is not me sitting down writing science fiction. Da Vinci got me thinking about this being raised up. Okay, so that's about where you'd be if you were up there. You'd be looking down. You're ascending if you go to those points there. Wow. And then I realized if you follow those points and your arms are sort of like holding the rope like an acrobat, you know, climbing on a trapeze or something, you would eventually disappear. You become smaller and smaller. And isn't that what happens? You know, as we truly elevate, we become more selfless. And as you become more selfless, you can detach and you can be a more objective observer of the world. And I suppose the ultimate is nothingness. You know that you're nothing.
Thanks for watching. Please like the video, share with friends, and hit the subscribe button. Please comment below and let us know what else you'd like to see on AIP.